Hey everybody, it's a new year and today we're talking about the last BCS National Championship game, the divisional playoffs, and what happens when an influential booster is not happy. All that and more, plus our Beasts and Busters on That's What She Said Sports. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Just had to get that out, right?
Yes, that was stuck up in my craw.
Hey everybody, welcome to That's What She Said Sports. I am your sports chick, Nicole Monique, and I am with my co-dude, as you can hear, BG.
Yeah.
And we want to welcome the rest of our sports chicks and dudes to That's What She Said Sports. And remember, you can always catch us on our podcast on Podbean, iTunes, and definitely catch us on our YouTube channel. So, B.
Yes.
It is a new year, my friend.
Yes, I ain't seen you since last year.
I know, right?
How you been?
I've been good, excited. Working good. Out a lot. You know, this is like
the year to get fit.
What?
Shouting. You just can't throw that out there like that.
Well, I'm just saying, this is a new year.
I'm working out.
Working out. New attitude.
That's what's up.
You know, 2014.
That's what's
trying
up.
Trying to get lean.
That's what's up.
So, yeah.
I'm going to jump on that same bandwagon, but I'm going to gotta find them pills first.
Yeah. Well, first of all, you've been under the weather.
Yeah, I have. I mean, literally under it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. For those that don't know, you know, we kind of had to do a prayer vigil.
Yes.
Because you were feeling pretty bad there for a minute.
Feeling pretty bad. Yeah. Man, I was, whew. Man.
It was ugly.
It was really ugly.
Yeah.
And you know, the sad part about it, man, is that I don't get sick that often.
Right.
So it's like I brought the entire house down. Mm. You know what I mean? My son was like, Dad, this is my first time seeing you really sick.
Yeah. You brought me down via text.
I know, man.
Describing how bad you were feeling.
Yeah, it was ugly, man. You know, it's crazy because, you know, so many times you feel like you can just bounce back from this stuff, man.
Right.
But there's some stuff out there now that will sit your behind down.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what happened to me, basically, man. So I didn't bring in the new year. You know, the family went to church and everything.
Right.
And they got back to find me on the couch sweating like I had the Ming Diamond in my pocket. You know, only to wake me up. But like, hey, man, you got a fever.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, I ended up, you know, New Year's Day just kind of taking whatever I had at the house.
But sometimes that's your body telling you, too. You just need to
slow down.
To regroup.
You need to slow it down. Regroup, replenish, refresh, and all that good stuff. So, went to urgent care on Thursday. Got some good drugs, and you know, I'm probably about 85%.
Yeah,
you know, but I mean, I know y'all here sound a little strange, but it's me. No, it really is. It's me.
But we are so glad to have you. Shake and bake 2014.
Shake and bake.
We got some big things going on in the new year. So we are excited.
I'm ready, man.
And speaking of excited,
yes.
Okay, for those out there, if you didn't watch the BCS National Championship game, I don't know what to tell you.
If you missed a minute, you missed a lot.
Yeah, because it was everything. Screaming, yelling, kicking, nail biting. And that was just me in the first half.
Yeah.
It was a lot.
Yeah. You know, I'm not going to even tell you about my experience, but it was a good thing I was at home.
Yeah.
And I'll just leave it there.
Well, look, let's just kind of do a little recap because it was one of those games where, I mean, it lived up to the hype. Now, you know what I'm saying? Because sometimes, I mean, because that's like the Super Bowl of college games.
It is.
Obviously.
It is.
So it is a big deal. And I know everybody was like, oh, it would have been better if Alabama and Ohio State had been there. Or it would have been better if Alabama.
Whatever. But, you know,
scratch that. FSU and Auburn did they thing.
Right
and let
on.
Me just tell you, from the beginning of the game, because you know, I had to go with my boy.
Right on.
Okay? And it's not about jumping on the bandwagon,
but you
folks.
Know what?
Okay, first of all, let me just tell you, if you are a true college football fan, you have to watch the game and you have to pick a team.
Right.
Okay. That's just how it goes.
Right.
I'm a Big Ten girl. Everybody knows that.
Right.
It was a house divided.
Right.
You know, married to an SEC man.
Exactly.
So right off the bat, he was SEC.
I got his hate text.
I wasn't. Okay. But if you listen to past podcasts, you will know.
Right.
I've always been a fan of Famous Jameis.
Right.
So I was. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I was feeling it.
Oh, yeah.
I was feeling it.
You know, it's a fluid motion. It's not like the robot. It's not like the robot.
Okay, because, I was kind of.
You got to chop that thing.
Doom, doom,
yeah.
Doom, doom,
yeah.
Doom, doom, doom.
Yeah, you're bringing it back to your rock on. You know, I thought you were going to start ticking up in this piece. But, yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I enjoyed that to the fullest.
But, B,
talk to me.
What were your thoughts at the beginning of the game, because obviously Auburn had the momentum.
Right.
I mean, they came out swinging. Right.
Well, here's the thing. I had a little conversation with my dad before the game started. Okay. And you know,
Mr. Willie,
exactly. So he was like, "Well, you already know how the game's gonna go, but I'm just saying, I just called you to, you know, get your feelings about it." So I told him, I said,
"Let me just say, Willie does not sound like that." But as we all know, B likes to give his dad, his wife, his son, different kind of voices. So just kind of, I had to protect your dad.
It's all good. You know, so. I love my dad, but you know, you know, I have to give him that old man mystique.
Right.
But I told him, I said, hey, if Florida State scores first, they win. Okay. And he was like, what do you mean? I was like, man, I'm telling you. I said, if it's not a bloodbath, that's going to be enough for them to feel like they can.
Right.
And I said, and a lot of times that's all you need.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's just that little glimmer, that little stardust to say, hey.
But Auburn made it difficult. I mean, they had
Auburn
the D,
made it extremely
They had the O. I mean, difficult. They had everything. And what I couldn't figure out is, why is it they were always leaving the middle wide open for Trey Mason?
Yeah.
It was no big shock.
Yeah.
They're going to give it to Trey Mason, but it was like Auburn, or excuse me, it was like the Noles couldn't figure that out. And did you think that they were rattled? Because I felt like he went from famous Jameis to rattled Jameis.
Right. Well, let me just answer that in two parts.
Okay.
First and foremost, in the defense, you have to pick your poison. And most times it's to stop their strength.
Right.
More so than to just cover everything up. And that's what they wanted to do. They wanted to attack Nick Marshall.
Okay.
That's what they did. They attacked him and Trey Mason. But when you do that, you are going to leave your back end free.
Okay. Because
you got to put, you know, extra men in the box.
Right.
The whole nine. So that's kind of the idea behind, you know, why the middle of the field was left open.
Yeah.
Now, here's the deal. Do I think Florida State has the athletes to, in those circumstances, to leave their corners on the island? Absolutely. And that's what they should have done. But they shouldn't have been outmanned on routes. And that's why the middle was so wide open, because they got outmanned on routes.
Right.
When you got a guy who looks like he's blocking, the next thing you know, he's out
But with that though, when you think, okay, fine, we saw that in the first half.
Right.
But then they were still doing the second half. I was like, come on, Jimbo.
Hey,
why are you not figuring this out?
Again, you're doing what you feel like is working for you. Let's stop their key players.
Right.
And make the rest of them beat us. Make them pass on us, because they haven't passed well. You know what I mean? History says that they're not great passers.
Right.
So let's see what they got. You know what I mean?
How are you feeling at the half when it was 21-10 and Auburn had the lead?
I was, you know what? I'm never rattled.
Okay.
Like, I got all the hate texts, you know what I mean? You know who you are. You know, about, oh man, your nose are down.
I happen to be married to one of the haters, you know, who was texting.
So, you know, your nose are down. You know, how you feeling?
Right.
You know, there is no feeling. You know, you're talking about a guy who was a coach that took a team that started out 0-4. From there, went undefeated, not only won the division championship, they won the grand championship and the Frank Ski's Future Bowl.
What? What?
In 2008. And it's
on
YouTube.
Yeah.
Be sure to check that out.
plug.
Exactly. So, I mean, you know, I was never under the suspicion of, oh, can we lose this ball game?
Well, and that's what I was feeling like, because I was like, folks, look, there's a reason why they're number one. There's a reason why they're 13-0.
Right.
You can have a team with a good quarterback that can be down.
Right.
Okay. And first of all, it wasn't like it was 48-0.
Exactly.
Many of teams, college and pro, are down 21-10.
Right.
That it's the momentum. And as we saw, what happened in the fourth quarter, that was key.
In any sport, there's ebbs and flows.
Right.
Football being no different.
Yeah.
But here's my thing, and I don't mind calling my own self out. You know, I've never been a full-on Jimbo Fisher supporter.
Okay.
And that's just simply because of, one, the ignorance and the unknown. You know, two, the unknown.
Right.
But, and it started because of the way that he came in. You know, I thought Bobby Bowden being an iconic figure, the guy who introduced the entire school to football, that he should go out on his own
accord. Right.
So
that's how you want a legend to kind of go out when they go
Make
out.
Make no bones about that. But I've also was the person that said that if he does not win the national championship this year, meaning in this year that he is since he's been in Florida State, that they will call for his head. You know, but he got a reprieve last year. He won an ACC championship and getting to a BCS bowl. So
was he almost like the Tom Coughlin of college football?
Not quite.
Okay.
But I see where you're going there.
Right.
But you know, but then again, too, then I had to stop and I had to really just dig deep and say, hey, wait a minute. This guy's got to have a chance to put his guys in place.
Right.
And when you have, you know, your staff being pulled and moved and people going to get head coaching jobs and things of that
nature. You got to weed them out. It takes time.
It affects the chemistry of what you're trying to do.
Right.
So
now he's got all his ducks in a row.
Right. So I had to say, okay, you know yeah. what, Jimbo, we've signed you.
Right.
You're our guy.
Right.
I'm going to ride with you.
Now, let's talk about the game changer. Speaking of Jimbo.
Right.
Making the decision to do the fake punt.
Right.
That scared me because obviously if it hadn't gone the way it did, we would have been talking about a totally different game.
I'm loving it.
Well, because it worked. But,
no.
But were you scared?
I'm loving it because he took a page from St. Bobby's book.
Okay.
When your team appears to be flat,
right.
You got to dare to be different. You got to do something.
I like that. Dare to be different.
Man, you got to do something to give him a shot in the arm.
Right.
You know what I mean? If it means running the ball.
And that is true.
And it comes in many ways.
Yeah.
If you're at fourth down and, you know, everybody's like, oh, fourth and 12, they're not going to go for that. You got to go for it.
Right.
You know
what I mean? That's kind of like a Tony Dungy thing.
Yeah.
He's kind of the coach that always goes for it. He's
right.
He's like, you don't have anything to lose.
And, oh my gosh, how fitting to give the ball to my man, Los Williams, on the fake punt.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful, man.
Yeah.
I almost teared up on that one. I promised myself I wasn't going to cry.
So we were talking about Trey Mason. He finished the game with 34 carries, 195 yards, and a touchdown. Obviously a beast. I mean, he was doing his thing.
You know what?
But this is what was interesting for me. There was people on both sides, whether it was Florida State or Auburn, who felt like he should have been the MVP because of all that he did throughout the whole game.
Right.
And I was telling people, that's not how it works.
No.
It's pretty much going to be what happens at the end and who wins.
Who wins.
Now,
correct.
If Auburn had won, he definitely would have been the MVP.
Right.
But at the end of the day, he didn't win.
Right.
And at the end of the day, it was about that last minute and 19 seconds. And let me tell you, my heart was racing, know, because I was texting.
Oh, man.
I was on Twitter.
Right.
It was
going
just
crazy.
I mean, the momentum
the
was. I mean, it was just nuts.
Yeah, man.
But that's when Famous Jameis stood up and reminded everybody, especially after Trey Mason had done his so-called Heisman Trophy pose.
Yeah.
Famous Jason said, "Hold up, wait a minute," and had to let everybody know.
Right.
Remind everybody that is.
Hey,
I won the Heisman Trophy.
Right.
And it was just amazing.
You know, and the thing about it is, the thing that I love about this kid, man, is that, you know, as talented and as blessed as he is, he's equally humble.
Right.
He's not only humble by what he does, he's humble by the entire experience.
Right.
You know what I mean?
He doesn't come across as a kid who's 20.
At all.
I mean,
he's a very old spirit.
Yeah.
Love that kid.
Yeah.
Man. Love that kid.
Just saying, a Redskins quarterback could take a page from the young buck.
Hello.
I'm just saying.
Hello.
So, speaking of the young buck, he was 20 of 35 for 237 yards and two fourth quarter touchdowns. Obviously, the one with 13 seconds left of the clock went to Calvin.
Big beast Benjamin.
I was going to say it's all about the Benjamins.
Already.
Because that was just, again, it was one of those where you almost get teary.
Yeah.
Because you're like, wow.
And here's the thing.
And honestly, I almost freaked out because still 13 seconds on the clock was a lot of time for me.
Oh, an awful lot.
Yeah.
An awful lot.
Yeah.
Because anything can happen.
Right.
Because remember the 1 second, right?
Yeah.
Hello, we'll never forget.
That's why it was kind of like, see the tables turned to where, okay, Auburn had the 1 second.
Yep.
And then look at FSU with the seconds that they had on the clock.
We'll never forget that.
Yeah.
Man, let me tell you something. Kelvin Benjamin is my guy.
And how tall is he?
6'5".
Okay, I was going to say he's like 6'5", 6'6".
He's not the fastest guy. He's not the cleanest route runner, although he's improved dramatically.
Yeah. He reminded me of Colston, who plays for the Saints.
Yeah, Marcus Colston.
Yeah, that's who you reminded me of.
Yeah. Here's a kid now. Here's a kid that just flat out didn't get it as a freshman.
Okay.
Did I say that?
Is he a junior or senior now?
He's a junior.
Okay.
Just flat out didn't. Yeah, he's a junior.
He didn't get it. Like his football IQ was just.
It was null and void. It wasn't even there.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To the tune of, he was in jeopardy of being sent home.
Mm.
Yeah. You know, but this kid changed his whole attitude.
Right.
His work ethic.
And that's usually the biggest piece, right? The attitude.
Man, I'm telling you. and here's one thing that I've always said to kids when I've coached them, especially those who have some deficiencies. When it comes to whether or not you love the game, that might be the difference to whether or not you will enjoy playing it.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, always stay coachable.
Now, okay, and this is something we were going to bring up at the end, but it's just so apropos to bring it up now.
Okay.
Johnny Manziel.
Right.
You know, you're talking about the love of the game.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure, as we all know, he's entering the draft. That's going to be a number one question.
Right.
I don't have any doubts the boy's talented. Okay. I'm not going to take that away from him. We don't even have to worry about the height thing anymore because you look at guys like Russell Wilson and Drew Brees.
Right.
But it's the love of the game. Are you going to have antics in the off season that are going to take over your love of the game? Or are you actually going to be practicing and keeping your head into the playbooks and trying to figure out the next season? And you just, you know, that just reminded me of that.
Right.
Because that's going to be a key piece.
You bring up a good point, and it's a very valid point indeed.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, it's like a wise woman once told me, always consider the source.
Right.
Johnny Manziel is not a kid that needs football. Okay, I'm going to say that again for those of you who might have missed that.
Right.
Johnny Manziel does not need football.
But you got to break that down because some people are like, I don't know what that means.
Oil money, man.
Yeah.
I mean, this kid is set up, and I'm sure he has a pretty hefty trust.
Right.
So you have to think about that. He's coming from a place of...
But then to kind of play devil's advocate with that, because, you know, obviously people are going to think, well, rich kids can play sports too. And we're not saying that they can't.
Right.
But it's that hunger.
Right.
It's that whole Deion Sanders, I want to buy my mama a house.
Bingo.
I want to get out of somewhere.
Right.
He's out.
Totally absent.
So it is.
Totally
it does have to come from here.
Right.
Heart, as far as that, to have that love.
Absolutely. Now... In all honesty, dude, I feel like he doesn't have the passion. No, I'm not saying that at all.
Right.
But I'm saying his actions definitely let me know who he truly is.
The bottom
line
is...
But it's not from a negative standpoint.
Right. What else is he going to bring to the table?
Exactly. I already understand. Hey, you know, he's a kid that has it all or has had it all, so to speak. And, you know, that's how he goes around life.
Yeah.
I mean, but that's the only way that he knows how to be.
Right.
So far as anything taking place off the field... I think he'll be fine.
Yeah.
Will he be like a Gronkowski? Absolutely.
Now,
will he get with an organization that may have to reel him in a little bit?
Right.
Hopefully.
Are you seeing first round?
Honestly, no.
Because that's amazing to me that all the talk has been first round. Somebody put him in the top five.
Right.
And I was like, you need to slow your roll.
Right. And I'll tell you this.
I think they're into the Johnny football hype.
Right. But my response isn't from... whether or not he had the skill set, because he's a hellified athlete, if I may say so. But I think we have to understand what the NFL has become.
Yeah.
The NFL is a lot about character.
Right.
And so perception is 100% truth in one's mind.
Yeah, because Roger Goodell is not going to play with you.
Hello. Thank you, Benita Betrayal.
With you, okay?
Benita Betrayal. Where have you been?
I know. You know, I can do a little. I can do a little ballet. I can do a little Benita.
I see that. Nice. That warms my heart to see that. Man.
Be quiet. And you too, producer said.
I'm trying to tell you. I'm thinking you're going to start saying stuff like Murphy. You know, good grief. But yeah, man. I mean, that's where we are. So... You know, in the grand scheme of things, is he going to get a fair shake? Probably not.
Right.
So he'll probably slip second
first
or third
time he
round.
Gets hit and they welcome to the NFL.
Yeah.
He'll feel it.
I'll tell you one thing. Those welcome to the NFL moments.
Yeah.
They are for real.
And some of my favorite moments. That's the part where I miss Ray Lewis.
Absolutely.
He was good to welcome in a nice, young, fresh QB into the NFL.
He was on the welcoming committee.
Right.
Hey, young boy, come over this way.
Hey,
got something I want to show you.
Well, speaking of the NFL, before we talk about the divisional playoffs, kind of have to take it back to the wild card weekend because we picked some teams. And the team I could not remember...
Right.
Had you picked the Bengals? I had you down for the Bengals. Okay.
Yeah, I had the Bengals. The Bengals.
And I did too. And as we know, we lost. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
We'll
get over it.
You had picked the Colts. I had picked Kansas City.
Right.
Okay. All righty. You see where I'm going with this.
Right.
Now, you had picked the Eagles.
I did.
And I had picked the Saints.
I picked the Eagles.
And that was like, what?
Right.
But my husband likes to think me picking the Saints helped them win. So,
well, now let me ask you.
You're
about
welcome,
this.
Honey.
Never to put the cart before the horse.
Yeah.
But
the horse.
The horse. Up in her. Up in here. The horse. You know what I'm saying? Like Chief Assault and Renegade.
Right.
The horse.
Right.
I mean, it's going to be like this all year long.
Yeah,
you know that, don't you?
Yeah, I do know that.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's going to be like this.
Yeah.
But, Who do you think is truly the better matchup for the next round, though?
Okay, well, real quick, I just want to pick to say that, first of all, I had messed up. It was
with it.
It was the, I think I got it mixed up. It was the Eagles. No, it was the Eagles and the Saints.
No, you're right.
And then the Packers and 49ers.
Right.
I picked the 49ers. You had picked the Packers. Right. So
I picked, I picked Discount Double Check.
So it was a hard, hard weekend. So now we go into the divisional playoffs where we have Saturday. We have the Saints versus Seahawks.
Right.
The Colts versus Patriots. Right. And then Sunday, we have the 49ers versus the Panthers.
Now let's back that thing up.
Now I know. I'm going to go back.
Okay.
So we can go over it.
I just, you know.
And then we have the Chargers versus the Broncos. Just want to put that out there for the folks. So Saturday. Saints, Seahawks.
Right.
They're playing in Seattle.
That's where we are.
12th man.
Right.
Loudest place in the NFL to play.
We already know what the truth is.
Right.
The truth is the Eagles lost. But who is truly a better matchup in Seattle?
The Saints.
You think so?
I do think so.
Now, here's where it gets real at.
Okay.
I'm going
it's about to get real.
It is. I'm going Hawks, and I'm going big. I'm going Hawks, and I'm going big.
First of all, it's so funny. I know we're talking football for a minute there. I thought you meant the Atlanta Hawks, and I was like, what?
What?
And then I had to come back and be the Seahawks, yeah.
Hello.
I was like, oh, my God, he's picking the Hawks.
Yeah. Don't worry about that. Don't.
You know what?
Anywho. I'm going Hawks.
Okay.
And I'm going big.
Okay. Well,
I'm going big.
I'm
going 2-touchdown big.
Okay. Well, I'm going to ride with the Saints again because they already beat them once during the regular season.
Right.
You know, Drew Brees in the playoffs is a beast.
Okay.
So.
Now let's down break it. You broke it down. Let's down break it. Russell Wilson at home.
I got you.
Okay. A little rest.
Yeah.
A little rest.
I like to chew gum Carol.
Right. A little rest.
You going to get it in.
You know, folks like
Marshawn Lynch.
Yep. A little rest.
Yeah. I got it.
And then you going to come in here with that?
I'm just saying.
All right.
Sometimes a team that comes off from just playing has that, you know.
Momentum.
They have that momentum.
A momentum.
Feeling it.
Okay.
Sometimes that team that had the rest.
Got their mo cheese mo.
I'm just saying.
All right.
So. And stop talking about my pick, okay?
No. Not talking about your pick. Just bigging my pick up. Big up pick.
Well, go with your Hawks.
Going with my Hawks.
I'm a ride with them Saints.
And my man Russy Russ.
And we'll see how it goes.
Okay, then. Well,
now, I need the Colts to stop Tom Brady. That's what I need.
Okay.
I'm going to need Andrew and all his luck.
Right.
To do what he got to do.
You know what, though?
Oh, Lord.
You know what? I'm okay with that.
Okay.
I really am.
Okay.
Because you saw what Andrew and his luck did at home.
Yeah.
And the number of points they put up.
Right.
I'm going to tell you, man.
Just pick a winner, please.
No, I said the Patriots, and I'm sticking there. I'm not going to welch.
Okay. Because
I said that last week.
All right.
And that's where I am.
Okay.
But the Colts are a problem.
Okay.
They really are.
I hope so.
I'm just. What?
Yeah. I need it.
Did you see how they played last week?
Yeah. Yeah.
They are a problem.
And during that game, I will be wearing my old school Peyton Manning Indianapolis Colts jersey.
You got one of those, do you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, shocker. Yeah, whatever.
All right, Sunday. 49ers versus Panthers.
Cam.
Oh, I thought you were going to ride that last Cam with me.
Oh, no, I'm riding Cam. I'm riding Cam all the way, actually.
Had a high five moment.
We had a high five. Yeah.
All right, so we got that one.
Okay.
Now, they beat them already in the regular season.
Right.
We know that.
Right.
The Panthers, they got that defense. Obviously, Cam is phenomenal.
Again.
But then on the flip side, we got the 49ers. We got another quarterback. Very similar. Kaepernick.
Hot.
But when you talk about the ingredients, separate the team and truly look at who has, forget playing at home. People always say playing at home is an incentive, but in the same token, this is the playoffs. There's some teams out there who can play away. 49ers is that kind of team.
Right.
But I'm still going with the Panthers. I think Carolina is going to ride this train.
Right.
And I don't know how far they're going to go.
Right.
But they're going to ride it as far as they can.
You get no argument from this side. But again, I say, here's the equalizer I'm thinking in all of this.
Okay.
The rest, man. The much needed rest. Gets you some bodies that can heal up. You know what I mean? Some much needed rest.
Right.
Oh my gosh. You know what I mean? Then hey, that if that doesn't give you an advantage, I don't know what does.
Right.
But on the other hand, when you got Cam, you got all the ingredients, as you say,
yeah.
And you got a defense that's playing lights out, let's settle it between the chalk lines.
Okay.
And I got Cam all day long. I'm riding Cam all the way.
Chargers versus Broncos.
Oh, my Lanta.
Yeah, I'm going with that orange. Yeah, and I will be rocking the brand new Denver Broncos t-shirt. What? For the game. Yeah. For,
look, I'm excited. I really am excited for her. Yeah.
Whatever.
You know what?
Who are you going for? I'm just saying.
I respect Manning. And, you know, of course, my boy won the Manning Award
today. I don't want to make you feel guilty, but I did help Florida State win the other night.
No.
I stayed up till 2 a.m.
No.
I did all the interviews, the press conference.
No, listen.
All that for Florida State and
you. No, listen. Saying. I'm there for you.
Okay.
I am there for you.
Okay.
I'm going with the horses, man. No. I mean, and my boy just won the Manning Award today, too. So, I'll ride with the Broncos.
All right. All right.
All right, whatever.
So
I got to because I can't cry you no river. That I can't do.
All right, so just a quick recap. I have the Saints, you have the Seahawks, I have the Colts, you have the Patriots. Saturday is gonna be very interesting.
Yeah.
Sunday though, we're together.
Together.
So Sunday, it's all about the Panthers and the Broncos.
Bingo.
All right, cool.
We're there. We right there.
And we'll have to get Sed's picks too. And
yeah, we'll let get you Sed's all know. Pick, and we're not talking picking. About his nose. So we'll get that from Sed.
All right, so
Inspector Gadget.
There's some drama in Texas. We all know, the Longhorns have named Charlie Strong their head coach. And as we all know, Strong is an African American coach, and Texas has not had a history of picking African American coaches. In fact, it's one of those unique things in the SEC, but now we have Charlie Strong for Texas, and then we have Kevin Sumlin for Texas A&M. So this is a big deal, and I don't think a lot of people actually kind of get that, but in the African American community, it's a big deal.
It is.
Now, recently, during a radio interview, longtime booster Red McCombs. Let it be known that he is not a fan of the Charlie Strong pick.
Right.
In a direct quote, he felt like the Charlie Strong pick, first of all, was a kick in the face. And let me give you a quote. He said, "I don't have any doubt that Charlie is a fine coach. I think he would make a great position coach, maybe a coordinator. But I don't believe he belongs at what should be one of the three most powerful university programs in the world right now at UT Austin. I don't think it adds up."
Right.
McComb is a huge booster. Okay.
Right.
He's also the former owner of the San Antonio Spurs, Denver Nuggets, and the Minnesota Vikings, and co-founder of the Clear Channel Communications. He has a business school at the university named after him, is the McComb School of Business. And he has a statue inside of the Memorial Stadium, the Darrell K. Royal Texas Stadium, of him. So this guy, big guy as far as influential. He's also donated over $100 million to the university.
Right.
So he obviously, when he talks, people listen.
Right.
So he was taken aback. He was stunned. He felt like it was a kick in the face.
Right.
Now, with all that, Charlie Strong had released a statement saying, "Hey, there are going to be statements made. You can't worry about that. You just have to move on. You have a job to do. You can't worry about what people think." Now, what I found was interesting is Michael Wilbon, one of my favorite guys.
Right.
He had said when all this came out that he was stunned, first of all, that Texas picked a black coach.
Right.
And what I found interesting is after he had actually made that announcement, there were some very high profile sportscasters, sports journalists who are white, who were actually shocked that Michael Wilbon, they felt, made such a big deal. They didn't see the significance. They felt like Charlie Strong was a great coach,
right?
Which we all do. We're not saying that he's not a great coach.
Right.
But in the same token, that would be like Alabama hiring a black coach.
Right.
It is that significant, and it is, like I said, some of us within the African American community were definitely shocked. B, I want to know from you, with everything that I've said, is this a big deal?
It is. It's a huge
on everything as far as Charlie Strong getting the hire.
It's a huge deal.
And the booster making a fuss.
It's a huge deal all the way around. Okay. But let's make no mistake. In 2014, you know, the schism is still around.
Right.
You know, Texas is, you know, I mean, they're not exempt.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I always felt like Charlie Strong was destined for a much bigger job.
Right.
was UT on the radar? No.
No.
Not in my mind.
No, because it
right.
We all just, I mean, you didn't think Charlie Strong in Texas.
Exactly.
You just didn't.
And for obvious reasons.
Right.
Because of what they don't do. Now, if this is the olive branch, is this a means of Texas saying, hey, you know, we've come a long way. See, look what we're doing.
Right.
I'm okay with that. But by the same token, again, I always felt like Charlie Strong was destined to do bigger things, go on to a much bigger school. Mm-hmm. But for it to be Texas, I did have my reserves, and that was the reason why. The other thing is that there is undertones always when you get these big universities
with big boosters
who just basically toe the line.
Right.
You always have it. Kevin Sumlin is not having a picnic.
Yeah.
At Texas A&M.
Oh, yeah. It's not all...
He's getting the hate mail.
Rosy.
Right.
In Texas A&M either.
Right. He's getting it all.
Yeah.
But the most pointed thing that I want to bring out is that it's real. You know what I mean? This is real.
Right.
This is actually happening here in 2014.
Right.
So those that are thinking like, oh, we've come so far and everything's fine. It's not fine.
Yeah.
And this proves just that.
Right.
That it's not fine. The other side of that is that the mentality of football there in Texas is football rules everything.
Right.
There's nothing else.
That's it.
There's football. So the recruiting.
It's God in football in Texas.
Exactly. So the recruiting trail for him is going to be made difficult as well.
Right.
And that's where it's going to really get personal.
Well, and especially you have a man here who, I mean, Charlie Strong is known for his recruiting. I mean,
right.
that's his thing, right?
Right.
But he's never recruited in Texas.
Exactly.
Now, he does have, I mean, he has a good relationship with a lot of those in the Southeast.
Exactly.
But as we all know, Texas is going to be a totally different beast.
A totally different animal. You know what I mean?
And then you kind of wonder, great, now Red McCombs has said something. Is that just going to make it even harder for him?
It is.
Oh,
it absolutely is.
And I failed to mention, he's also a really good friend, as far as Red McCombs, of Mack Brown, the former coach of Texas.
Emphasis on friend.
And former coach.
Exactly.
Who still plays a big part in that community.
Yeah. You know, it's unfortunate that, you know, such a great opportunity has to have such a black eye attached to it. You know what I mean? But I'm glad.
Right.
I'm glad because it needs to be brought out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
My heart goes out to Charlie because I know what he's about. I know the time and the effort that he puts in to make these boys men.
Yeah. And he deserves the shot. And all the way around, it's just sad that in 2014 we have to have this conversation. And I know it's quick for people to say, well, why do you always have to bring the race thing up? Why do you have to bring the race card? Well, first of all, being black, that card is always there.
Bingo.
As far as whether I turn it over or not, it just kind of depends on the situation.
Right.
And this is a situation where you were just kind of waiting. It was kind of too good to be true after he got announced and nothing came out. So I don't think we were all too shocked that Red McCombs all of a sudden made the comment or said what he said.
Right.
Because he may have said something, but you just know other people feel the same way.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's my whole thing. I have much more respect for you if you go ahead and voice your feelings.
Right.
You know what I mean? If you're
put it on the table.
Bingo. That way we can agree to disagree and I can say, okay, fine, that's how you feel.
Right.
Just as Charlie did.
Right.
Now I got to be about my business.
Right.
You know what I mean? So what? You gave $100 million.
Yeah.
You've never coached a game of football you never will.
Right.
So let me do me. You do you.
Right. So, okay. So obviously Charlie Strong has left Louisville.
He's gone.
So what does Louisville do? You just break up with someone. You break up with somebody who's the love of your life. They've done everything for you, okay? You never go back to an oldie but goodie. But that's what Louisville has done. They have called Bobby Petrino and offered him the job.
You hold up. I almost cursed. Did you see that?
Yeah, I saw the pregnant pause.
I almost cursed.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yes.
You know what? Yeah. I heard that, but I was like, nah, that's just, you know, it's just people talking.
And for those who are not aware who Bobby Petrino is, not only was he used to be the coach at Louisville, and then he went to the Falcons.
Right.
Then he snuck out of Atlanta one night.
Mr. Freaky Harley Davidson himself.
And went to...
Western Kentucky?
No, he went to Arkansas.
Oh, Arkansas, yeah. Big Sioux,
Because it was all about them.
That thief in the night, that little creep out in the night.
And then while he was at Arkansas,
the next morning, he like Big Sioux.
He decided to ride a motorcycle with a very attractive younger woman.
Freaky Harley.
Who was
that's what they call
friend
him.
Got jacked up, and then he had to go to Western Kentucky. Right. And that's just the Cliff Note version, folks. You can get the rest on the internet.
Man.
Yeah, Bobby Petrino.
OMG. Yeah. Come on, Louisville, don't do it.
This mug has more than 9 lives.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I love when I give you breaking news because I love to see it on your face.
Meanwhile, you got my boy, my man, who I love, Sylvester Croom's at home chilling.
Yeah.
Eating Wheat Thins out the box. Right. Like he can't coach no more. Right. Like he done.
Yeah.
Give my man a shot.
Yeah.
But you're going to call back Bobby?
But actually, the kids wanted him. The kids wanted him back.
Because do they know? They're kids.
did your voice just go up a little, Mariah?
It did.
What do they know?
It did. Sorry about that. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah. So it's just been a wacky
midnight love.
48 hours to say the least. So
that's crazy, man.
Yeah.
That is the most insane thing that I've heard all day.
Well, I'm glad I could share that with you.
Thank you. Smell it much.
I'm glad I could share. Well, folks, thank you so much for joining us again at That's What She Said Sports. I am your sports chick, Nicole Monique, with my co-dude, BG.
Yep, that's me.
And it's now time for our Beast and Busters.
Bust a bus.
And we have a really great Beast tonight. It was just announced. We have Greg Maddux, Tom Glavin, and Frank Thomas have been named to the 2014 Baseball Hall of Fame class. And not only a great day for Cooperstown, but a great day for the Atlanta Braves.
Nice.
Maddux, Glavin, and Cox. Oh, my.
Bobby Cox is my manager. Nice. That's what's up.
Yeah.
Go Bravo. Yeah.
And then to have Frank Thomas, who I used to think Frank
the big
Thomas
hurt?
Could play football personally.
Straight up and down.
Yeah.
Straight up and down.
Yeah.
If not a tight end, he could be a pulling guard.
Yeah.
I mean, straight up.
Yeah, so it's just awesome. And then, unfortunately, obviously, with this, we've had a lot of PED conversation.
Right.
You know, the usual suspects didn't get in.
Right.
Bond, Sammy Sosa, the whole thing. That's a totally different conversation. But, and actually, you know, as far as the...
I understand why Bonds can't get in. I mean, he was on that clear.
Yeah. But, you know, it is what it is.
It's not like he had a needle stuck in his bunkie. Let him in. He was on that clear.
All right, folks. Now it's time for our Busters.
Bus a bus.
And we have a twofer for you coming all the way from...
You got a special?
Yes, all the way from Alabama.
Oh, man.
First up on the list, AJ McCarron's mother, Dee Dee. Who sent a tweet after the BCS National Championship game commenting on Jameis Winston and how he was talking at an interview after the game. She tweeted, "Am I listening to English?" Then realizing the whole world can actually see your tweets and people start commenting on it, she deleted it. But as we know, all things on the internet, besides being true,
hello,
they never go away.
It's out there.
Okay.
If it's on the internet, it's true.
With the twofer, we now have Catherine Webb, AJ McCarron's girlfriend, who thought the tweet was hilarious and decided to favorite the tweet. Yeah.
Yeah. Favorite dummy. Why would you do that, Dee Dee?
I mean, seriously.
Why would you do that?
Good old fashioned.
Now, we don't get out there on the internet talking about her fake boobies. We don't do that.
Wow.
We don't go out there saying how she done spent the boy two. No, well, let me stop.
You went back to sixth grade with boobies.
Yeah, I didn't want to. Yeah. It is what she said, so I'm trying to, you know.
I got you.
I'm trying to keep us a few listeners and followers.
But let me tell you, hate does not look good. And
it
I get
doesn't.
It.
Doesn't.
And I get it. Your son was number two.
It's like a bad hairdo.
In the Heisman Trophy votes.
Right.
Number two. But let me tell you something, Dee Dee. Good things can come out on number two. Scottie Pippen was a great number two.
He was. He really was.
Okay, that's a bad example.
Yeah.
KG was a good number two.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Got some other number twos?
Let's see. Mo Cheeks.
Andrew Luck was a number two behind RG3.
Right. Yeah. True.
Yeah, so see, you number twos are good.
Number twos aren't bad.
I mean, granted, AJ McCarron's career could go any way in the NFL.
It could.
He could be Andrew Luck.
Or
he could be Matt Leinart.
Or he could be far on the bench that Dee Dee would need some binoculars to find him.
With her boobies.
Heffa. Excuse my French. Y'all excuse me. I'm sorry that slipped. I'm sorry. I take that back.
Speaking of Heffa.
Right.
Dennis Rodman.
Oh.
Yeah. Seriously. Dennis, all I have to say is stay off TV. I understand you're North Korea. I can't even get it out. And you're trying to bring everybody together. but you looked ridiculous. In fact, he looked like a wrestling announcer. Said our producer does a really great imitation of that. I mean, he looked ridiculous.
WWE.
Yeah, man. But you know what, Dennis Rodman, I mean, y'all have to forgive me. Please, y'all forgive me before I even said it out of my mouth.
Here it comes.
But that dude is ugly. I mean, when you're talking about Harry Potter, Hogwarts, that's his face, Hogwarts. I'm like, dude, with skin like that?
Right.
Man, you can smooth a diamond straight out on that thing. I mean, good grief. He needs some DOT in his life.
Yeah.
To cover some of them potholes.
Wow.
I'm just saying. Wow. Man. I mean, dude's skin is awful.
Okay, so... you find him unattractive. That's what I'm hearing.
So is that what I'm hearing? Yeah, dude need to just put gauze on his face. I mean, really. Just put gauze on it and just keep it real.
Well, he needs to be quiet because... I mean,
now, don't get me wrong. The sunglasses are an improvement.
Yeah.
But you need more, player.
Right.
You need more.
Right.
You know, start wearing, you know, just cover it up. Yeah. You know, like you Israeli or something. Yeah. Just cover it up.
Well, he needs to be quiet. I mean, in a country where a man has just recently killed his girlfriend and his uncle. He is not going to have any qualms.
You ain't ready for that.
About killing you.
Yeah, you ain't about that life, Dennis. I don't care how ugly you are. You are not about that life.
No. And that would be one American where Barack Obama is going to be like, Michelle and I are in the middle of dinner. This is not a good time.
Following. What? Oh, bet.
You're right.
All
right.
Cool.
Yeah, I'm good. I have healthcare issues.
Yeah,
I got to go.
Cool.
It's not going to work.
Cool. I'm trying to plan my wife's 50th.
So final buster goes to, and this one is a classic.
Okay.
All right. The NBA, I had to give them a whole buster. Yeah. You heard me, David Stern.
Wow. The whole national basketball.
I had to. For fining J.R. Smith $50,000 for the whole shoelace thing, where when they were playing the Dallas Mavericks and he untied Sean Marion's shoelaces. $50,000.
$50K.
Honestly, for that much money, he should have just hit him in the head.
$50K. He could have hired me to do it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Right.
David Stern is not playing.
No.
He been hanging out with Goodell or something.
I don't know.
They had dinner.
That man likes to collect some money
and stuff.
He is worse than the IRS when it comes to taking money from folks.
David Stern ain't playing no more. Yeah. He's taking this thing serious.
Yeah. So I thought you would find that interesting.
Wow.
Well, before we go, I wanted to send a special happy birthday shout out to my little sister, Tori.
Oh,
yes.
Happy birthday.
It's her birthday. So happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Tori.
And now we just want to say thank you so much for watching and listening.
Thank you.
That's what she said, sports. Right.
Happy birthday, Coach Cheeks, Big Cheeks, Coach Reed. It's his birthday, too.
Good.
January 8th.
So remember, you can catch us on podbean.com. You can also catch us on iTunes. And don't forget our YouTube channel.
Right on.
And definitely be sure to visit our website. We have some really good posts out there.
Right.
TWSSSports.com.
.com.
Again, that's TWSSSports.com. Follow us on Twitter. I'm at TWSS Sports BG.
And I'm at Big BG, the number one.
And don't forget to like us on Facebook.
Love us.
Follow us on Twitter.
Follow us.
And definitely subscribe to our YouTube channel. I know this seems like it's a lot, but come on, folks. You can do it.
BG, subscriptions are good.
Any last words?
And delicious. We like. I'm sorry. I was in the moment.
Yeah,
so.
you were flowing.
I'm sorry. No, I don't have any last words. Y'all just follow us, man, especially on Twitter, man. The BCS banter was going down.
Oh, yeah.
Man.
We had a good time.
I mean, y'all missed it, man. You had people out there hating on me for no reason, man. But, you know, when you get out there, you know what I'm saying? You got that garden and goal on, you know what I mean? And you know-blooded like that. You know, it happens, man. And I'm just happy that my girl jumped on the Noel train before.
I did. I jumped on it.
Before we
I just
got
to learn how to do
station.
The chop.
Yeah, don't
How's this better?
We're going to work on that.
Okay.
We'll work on that a little bit later because, you know, I know you got some issues with the whole rhythm thing, but we'll work on that.
Wow. Seriously?
We'll work up to that.
Boy,
please, don't
let me pull out the...
Oh, you saw me dance.
And do the cash patch right now.
You saw
me
dance.
Yes, I just dated myself.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll have a bankhead bounce off up in this
piece. You want to dance off?
What?
Just let us know.
You don't want none. You ain't about that life. You don't want none.
All right.
You don't want none.
Okay.
But as always, folks, and party, the BG stands for be good. Till next time.
Till next time, folks.